I had the title poet, and maybe I was one for a while. Also, the title singer was kindly accorded me, even though I could barely carry a tune.
Now Suzanne takes your hand and she leads you to the river.
Maybe Leonard Cohen can't sing like an angel, and maybe he's ambivalent about the title poet. But for decades, a legion of fans has memorized his words.
Like a bird on a wire.
And other musicians have loved to perform his songs.
I have tried in my way to be free.
Everybody rolls with their fingers crossed. Everybody knows that the war is over.
Everybody knows the good guy's lost.
In poetry, novels, and most of all, a host of recordings, Cohen has been the romantic and seeker. Solitary, at times reclusive, once youthful, now aging, able to express complex ideas and emotions with language, even in a 3-minute rhyming song.
My heart is filled with gratitude.
And his 71st year is proving to be a special one. In February, Cohen, who was born in Montreal, was inducted into the Canadian Songwriters Hall of Fame.
If I knew where the good songs came from, I'd go there more often.
A new documentary on him has just been released, featuring a performance with rock superstars U2.
Well, you can say that I've grown bitter, but of this you may be sure. The rich have got their channels in the bedrooms of the poor, and there's a mighty judgment coming.
And now Cohen has published Book of Longing, his first new collection of poetry in 20 years. I spoke with Leonard Cohen recently at Arena Stage Theater in Washington. Oh,
yeah. Did you start out seeing yourself as a poet or aspiring to be a poet?
I never thought of myself as a poet, to tell you the truth. I always thought that that poetry is the verdict that others give to a certain kind of writing. Call yourself a poet is a kind of dangerous description. It's for others. It's for others to use.
But what were you doing when you started out? How did you see yourself?
You know, you scribble away for one reason or another. You're touched by something that you read. You want to number yourself among these illustrious spirits. For one advantage or another, some social, some spiritual. It's just ambition that tricks you into the enterprise. And then you discover whether you have any actual aptitude for it or not. I always thought of myself as a competent minor poet. I know who I'm up against.
You know who you're up against.
Yeah, you're up against Dante and Shakespeare, Isaiah, King David, Homer, you know. So I've always thought that I, you know, do my job okay.
There's a poem in this new book called Thousands.
Thousands,
sort of on
right.
This subject. Want to read that for us?
Yeah, this is a very short one, but I think it speaks to the point. It's called Thousands. Out of the thousands who are known or who want to be known as poets, maybe one or two are genuine and the rest are fakes, hanging around the sacred precincts, trying to look like the real thing. Needless to say, I am one of the fakes and this is my story.
I am one of the fakes and this is my story.
That's right.
What's the difference for you between writing a poem and a song?
A poem has a certain, a different time. For instance, a poem is a very private experience and it doesn't have a driving tempo. In other words, you know, you can go back and forward, you can come back, you can linger. It's a completely different time reference. Whereas a song, you know, you got a tempo. You know, you've got something that is moving swiftly. You can't stop it. You know, and it's designed to move swiftly from, you know, mouth to mouth, heart to heart, where a poem really speaks to something that has no time, and that is it's a completely different perception.
One of the things I've always noted in your work is the mix of the sensuous and the spiritual, I guess, the body and the soul. Is that a fair description of what you're up doing?
But you know, we got both. You know, so it's not.
We do have both.
Yeah, we do have these feelings that you know, run from coarse to elevated and refined. Everybody's got them, you know. And then we're stuck with this, you know, this body, you know, that, you know. I mean, we're all dying of this incurable disease called age.
The sense of aging is in this book.
Yeah.
Is that signify you are in fact feeling that?
Oh, of course. Sure. Of course you feel it, you know. My friend Irving Layton, our greatest Canadian poet, he said the inescapable lousiness of growing old.
The inescapable lousiness of growing
That's
old.
That's right. That's right.
Is most of your writing in fact autobiographical? Is that fair?
Yeah, that's fair. That's fair. But, you know, autobiographical takes in a lot, you know, which it also includes the imagination. You know, your imagination also has a history. It also, you know, is born, grows old, suffers decay and old age and dies. You know, so the imagination is part of the whole autobiography.
There's a poem called Mission, which
That's
expresses
right.
some of this life
sure.
yearning, I guess. Would you
sure.
read that for us?
Oh, thank you for asking me. I'd love to. I think I remember that poem. Mission. I've worked at my work. I've slept at my sleep. I've died at my death. And now I can leave. Leave what is needed and leave what is full. Need in the spirit and need in the whole. Beloved, I'm yours as I have always been, from marrow to pore, from longing to skin. Now that my mission has come to its end, I pray I'm forgiven the life that I've led. The body I chased, it chased me as well. My longing's a place, my dying's a sail.
Leonard Cohen, thank you for talking to us.
Oh, thanks so much for having me. I appreciate it very much.